Hey everybody, Jay Barino here. Thanks for joining me today. I've got a vlog for you. Not really a channel update, just more of a stream of consciousness of things that have been in my mind at a meta level for the channel. Just talk about some topics. The primary one that's been on my mind, especially now that I finished my Warcraft 3 Reforged series yesterday, is sort of around building on my core audience, building upon my core audience. Because one of the things that's really become apparent to me is, you know, a series like Warcraft 3 Reforged will bring in new viewers, but will it build a core audience? And I think it will, to a degree, just naturally. But what I'm looking for, folks who are watching this, you're probably not watching this unless you're a core audience member, is, you know, what is it about the Jay Barino brand, for lack of a better term, that you feel is important to you? Because I view the way my motivation for making content in three levels. The foundational one is my own enjoyment, right? If I don't want to do something, I'm not going to play it. So it has to meet that criteria. And when I started making videos on YouTube, I had my own motivation, which was, it doesn't matter if people are watching this, but I had sort of a completionist vibe where I really enjoyed my first playthrough of Donkey Kong Country. It was 101% uncommentated on my channel. It's still there. But it's sort of immortalizing that level of completion of a game. And typically that went hand in hand with not playing it blind, so that way I could put my best foot forward for that sort of, again, immortalized playthrough. Again, I realize it's not immortalized, and they could disappear at any moment because they live on servers that I don't own. But regardless, the sentiment is still there. And that's kind of that was my core initial motivation. Building upon that, though, again, I grew a core viewer base, small, but existed with my Mass Recall series. And they began recommending things that I was not aware of. Specifically, hey, go play Perfect Soldiers, this custom campaign for StarCraft II. Had I not had that recommendation, I would have never even been exposed to this just slew of content and a bunch of different communities as well, for better or for worse. And I think that's absolutely key, which is why I'm kind of revisiting it now, and I want to make sure that I revisit this every so often, which is to maintain a connection to my core viewer base, as opposed to just chasing views. And I kind of hate to say this, it's an admission, but it's true, is I feel like that Warcraft 3 Reforged series was chasing views. And from that perspective, I guess that only is apparent in retrospect, because I'm not going to discount the fact that my core viewer base did or did not enjoy that. I don't know, and that's kind of what the feedback I'm looking for. And based on the comments, you know, I recognize most people who comment a lot that I would consider part of like the core viewership who did enjoy that series, so I'm happy for that. But, you know, I look at my motivation for it, and after I played the first campaign or the second campaign of the seven, and I realized these are all of the, well, not seven, nine of the nine campaigns, right? Eight campaigns. of the eight campaigns. When I realized that really nothing had changed, I should have just committed to showcasing the changes as opposed to doing a whole playthrough. And then when I finished it, you know, I'm happy with the series, but it makes me look back and say, you know, what is it about that my core viewership liked? And I do get comments that I greatly appreciate, and I believe are true, of people who say, Jay, as long as you're playing it, I'll watch it, and that's great. I appreciate that. What I'm trying to figure out is why. You know, what is it about my the way that I play or the personality that I bring that I would say is appealing to a core audience as opposed to, you know, brand new viewers? Because I've reached the point where, you know, growing in subscribers is not that important to me, nor is it really reflective of true viewership. And that's the case for most channels, especially once you reach a certain threshold. Subscriber count is just, you know, people disappear faster than they're coming in new. And so that's just, I think, the way it is. Also, I can see that, you know, I have a ton of views that are from non-subscribers. And a lot of those may be core viewers, but they just never subscribe because there's never been a call to action to subscribe, which, by the way, works. Let me go on a brief tangent here. Is I realize it's intrusive and annoying when people say, hey, hit that like button, hit the bell, subscribe, etc., etc. But if you can find an unobtrusive way to do it, it works. So as much as some people may hate to know that it works, it works. And it's more just my own curiosity. If I were to start, you know, in the middle of a video or near the end of a video, just very briefly saying, hey, I'm curious. I can see a lot of you aren't subscribed but watch my videos. I'm kind of curious, you know, if you're interested, please subscribe. And then I'll come back next week and I'll show you. I'll give you a snapshot of the analytics and we can see how much or if they went up. Just because, again, for my own curiosity, and I want to be genuine in my motivation for doing that, which is, I think, again, a call to action works, and it's not that I expect people to do it, it's more that I understand from their perspective, you're just sitting back and watching a video, and you might like it, but you don't hit the like button, and why should you, right? Again, what's the motivation? But a simple call to action to say, you know, If you actually did like this video, if you think it deserves a like, I recognize that you may not always take the action to hit the button. So I'm asking you to take that action and hit the button, right? It's that, to me, it's that straightforward. It's not like begging for likes or begging for subscriptions. But I'm just sort of curious to see how that quantifies into, like, a translating into, you know, a subscription if I were to bring that up. And I don't have that expectation on this video because this video is not reaching out to new subscribers, and anybody who's never seen a video from me who opened this has already closed it by this point. Anyway, that's that tangent, but going back to my core viewership, it's trying to figure out again how I can connect more with my core viewership, because many times many of you have given me great ideas for new content to play, and not just, you know, what to play for the channel, but also have just provided fun and interesting conversations either in the comments sections or on my Discord. And I say conversations, admittedly, I don't respond to every comment, nor could I. I don't respond to nearly as many comments as I should or want to, but I read them all. So I guess I log it as a conversation in my head, but a lot of you have interesting things to say and, you know, funny things to say, and those are the comments I appreciate the most, and I don't respond to them as much as I should. And there's an adage which is absolutely true, and I learned this too recently. I should have learned this much, much earlier, but I learned this from my Command & Conquer videos, and I learned this from my Reforged series, which is you need to respond and give attention to comments that you want more of. So if you have a comment that's, for me, it's particularly interesting stuff. So if someone leaves a fun fact or something funny or anything, you know, that's remotely positive or even just neutral, but again, is at least interesting, those are the comments that I will try to respond to. Again, I can't respond to every one, but that's the general type of comment I'll look to respond to, because those are the comments you'll get more of. There's no point in responding to negative comments, because what you're doing is saying, not so much, hey, trolls, I'll take the bait. It's more just to your viewers that want to connect with you, viewers that want to connect with me, they'll say, okay, well, he's responding to the negative comments that are saying that he's playing poorly. So if I want him to respond to me, not in a trolly way, but I just want his attention, which I guess is partly, trolling is a subset of that, then I need to leave negative comments, because that's how I can interact with Jay Barino. So it goes both ways with positive comments as well. Like, I'm not looking for artificially positive stuff. I'm just saying that that's how you, the content creator, if you are one, and me, can curate your community a little bit, which is, again, interact with the stuff that you actually like, which is the same as telling someone, if you actually like a video, hit the like button, right? Make sure that you give appreciation to the things and the people that you actually appreciate, and don't let it go unnoticed. It's very easy to focus on the negatives. It's very easy to internalize negative remarks and be baited into replying to them. But again, recognize the long term of that, and it's just a helpful attitude to have, and overall it's been very refreshing for me. Again, I learned it, like, especially in the Reforged and Command & Conquer series, where, you know, Command & Conquer is one of those series that brings in new viewers, but they're Command & Conquer enthusiasts who don't particularly, as far as I can tell, they don't really care for the framework of me playing something blind. So I get a lot of backseating gaming comments, and also spoilery comments, and also just outright mean comments. but they reduced dramatically after I stopped responding to them. It's really that simple. And again, everybody knows this going onto the internet in general, but being able to actually apply it, especially when you're in a position where you're receiving such a torrent of feedback constantly, right? Knowing, oh, I shouldn't respond to the troll when, you know, one guy responded to you on Reddit is very easy. But when you're getting 100 comments, it's a lot harder. again, because you're filtering through them. And I try to make a point to always remember that my commenters are people. They're not just robots, and some of them are mean and some of them are not, right? So when you're really making an attempt to personify a lot of the comments, it's easier to take things more personally, especially negative stuff. Anyway, another just tangent about comments. But I guess sticking to the Command and Conquer, this is a stream of consciousness. We're jumping from thing to thing. But the Command & Conquer series is a good question I'd want to pose to my core viewership, which was the framework for that was I played it blind. Didn't really meet, you know, my core... The core foundation was I wanted to play Command & Conquer. My core viewership thought it would be interesting, right? But what it lacked was I didn't have an understanding of the game to play through a playthrough that I myself would have wanted to watch if someone else made that series, right? I would have liked to have found a series of someone playing Command & Conquer that was skillful at it, and or at least knowledgeable about it. And I didn't meet that that standard. I still enjoyed playing it, but what I want to understand is, does my core, how does the core viewership feel about that? You know, is it interesting to see me play stuff blind, or would you prefer that I do, like, one of the playthroughs I'm most proud of is my StarCraft II walkthrough. It was like 91 parts, it was the entirety of the campaign collection, and I knew those maps inside and out, and I feel like I absolutely killed that series. I loved recording it, I loved putting it out, I loved getting feedback for it. And that's what I really liked making. But it also took a lot more time because I needed to practice. And it just was a game that I had a lot of experience in. To do that with all the Command & Conquer games would have taken an astronomical amount of time and likely would have just led me not making the videos at all. So I'm just trying to understand again. I am absolutely cool playing things blind, especially on stream. But I'm trying to understand again, is that a framework that you all like? Did you prefer the pre-planned series of Warcraft 3 and Starcraft 2? I think the community content is a totally different thing, and that's just, it's always going to be blind. So that way I can give reasonable feedback. Okay, my phone rang, so there's going to be an awkward cut in the video. Anyway, I was talking about, playing things blind just so that I could give content creators, you know, the best off-the-cuff feedback as someone new coming and playing the game, because I think that's the best way to test a map. If I gave them feedback after my third playthrough, it doesn't really give them a clear picture on what it was like for someone new coming and playing it, obviously. Anyway, the last topic I was going to touch on is social media. Obviously, YouTube is its own brand of social media, so I use that. I use Discord quite a bit. I have my own J Burrito server, if you're unaware. And a lot of the core viewership is there as well, and I have had a lot of interesting conversations there, and I try to be active there as well. And then being on Discord kind of opens you up to a lot of the different project communities as well. So a lot of them intermix with different members, but you can go to different ones to have, you know, specific focuses. You know, if you want to talk about UED AIP, you might find it through the J Burrito server, but you can talk about that project specifically with feedback and testing and such on their Discord. So I've really enjoyed that, but it's not really an outreach social media. And I don't really use or like Twitter. Very rarely will I follow a link to Twitter for like a meme or something from like Reddit, for example. And then I'll realize the J Burrito Twitter has notifications. I don't know. It happens every so often. But I never go and I check, and I don't really have a network on Twitter. I don't know. I guess I'm just looking for advice or feedback on how to properly use that platform. I guess it's more about building a network with other content creators and official outlets from game developers and such, just to be able to glean information that I otherwise am not getting, right? And then actually being active and, you know, retweeting or making my own pertinent... I don't know. I just feel weird, like, I guess commenting on everything else other people say. It just seems like a weird feedback loop. But I guess that's what all social media is. It just feels, Twitter specifically just feels kind of strange to me. So I've just never really been able to pin down how to use that platform. So I would love some feedback there. Or maybe I just won't do it. I don't know. But it seems like a great way for me to get networked in with other content creators, which is what I would like to do. And Discord's good for that too. But, you know, everyone has their own Discord, and I lurk on most Discords. I read them, but I don't participate because I'm participating on my own. So in that sense, again, it's not as good for networking, I suppose, but it's good. It's a good way to, you know, have direct chats open with anyone you need to. I also enjoy Discord, again, just because I can have constant conversations. YouTube comments don't really allow for that. So, like, there can be a topic ongoing, and you can have an active chat with someone, and the Discord's really good for that. And because it's my Discord, I can kind of set the atmosphere that I want it to be. And I have a server statement, which is kind of the core of the rules of the server, which is basically, like, just chill. Chill out. If you ever are not chill, you need to regulate yourself. And if you can't, then you don't belong here. It's really that straightforward. One thing there's been all sorts of goofy Discord drama in the past, and it's real easy for that to get out of control. I've learned a lot. Specifically, I think it's just, you know, use Discord to connect with people that you get along with. That's the best use of it. I'm not concerned about an echo chamber regarding community content for a video game, right? It's a shared hobby. It's not like we're talking about, you know, what path we need to take to address climate change, right? Where we need all the voices possible and addressing disagreements and such. Though I guess that's another instance where perhaps if you disagree a little too much, you should be shut out of the conversation because it's an important thing and we shouldn't be denying it. But that's neither here nor there. Discord can spiral out of control, but moderation, or rather, not even moderation, but proper administration is necessary to, again, set an atmosphere that you want. And it's the same with the YouTube comment situation. You build the atmosphere you want. And if it goes somewhere that you don't want, it's probably partially your own fault as well. And again, these are things that I've learned. As a content creator or a server administrator or whatever, you are responsible for how things turn out a lot of the time. You know, some stuff may be out of control if you get just like a really concerted effort of a people who want to run you into the ground, which is extremely rare. I don't know how and when that happens and who would take the time to do that. But again, if you feel that, you know, a space that you are curating and administrating is not what you want, you have the control to change it. And that's important to do, again, if it's not what you want. I want, you know, my server, I want my comment section, I want my channel to be welcoming. I mean, it doesn't mean that no one can be negative, right? I welcome criticism and just honesty. But if you're someone who just can't stop jumping down people's throats over everything, then you don't belong on my Discord server or you don't belong in my comment section, right? So I think I recognize it as just like not every community is for every person. I think everybody can find a place where they do fit in, but it's not literally everywhere. Right? Just like you wouldn't join like a rock climbing hobbyist group if you didn't rock climb. But it's just, you know, having that general self-awareness to recognize like, oh, hey, I'm not really providing anything useful or fun to this group, and all I'm doing is ruining the mood. Shocking that I have been banned. I'm shocked that, you know, all I've done is provide negativity and shit over all over everyone. But look at these tyrants banning me or shadow banning me from their comments section or their Discord server. It's like, and no one's ever happy when they get banned from somewhere, I guess. I guess I don't know. I can't really empathize because I typically have not been super hostile and been banned. And I guess if I have, I don't even know if I have been banned from somewhere. But I just think, like, if I got banned from somewhere, my first thought would be like, no. Oh, well, I guess they didn't want me there. Like, and then you move on. But anyway, again, this is a totally different tangent. But yeah, using Discord basically to focus on the things that we like and enjoy as a hobby together, as opposed to, you know, it's a source of endless political debate. Like, we actually, surprisingly enough, you can ask the people that are on the Discord. We've talked about politics many times, and it's always been fine. It's never been insufferable. And I pride myself on that because, again, I'd like to think that I'm curating a user base of people who are active participants that know how to converse with people in a reasonable way. And it's not that we've shut out everybody that disagrees with us, It's just that you can disagree and not go fucking crazy. It's just that easy. And I don't know. I take pride in that, I think, at this point. And I think everybody should who can have a community like that. So I'm going to continue trying to do that. But again, to kind of circle it back, I'm looking for what those folks who are, you know, the power users, the core channel members, you know, what are the details around those things that really draw you into, I mean, I hate to ruin the magic, but the brand, right? Jay Barino is a brand. I am not Jay Barino. My name is Justin. My brand, my YouTube name is Jay Barino, right? And I make things that are entertaining because I enjoy doing it, and I'm really, really happy to know that you all enjoy it too. So I'm trying to get your feedback on that as much as possible. And again, these things have just been swirling around in my head lately, specifically because I've gotten a big increase of new viewers, interestingly enough, from the Command & Conquer series, and then also, unsurprisingly, from Warcraft 3 Reforged. But the question is, how do I convert them into more core viewership? And if you are a new viewer for one of those, and you have become a channel regular, you know, what was it that drew you in? That's what I'm looking for. Because I don't think that you can convince people to become a core viewer. They either find you and they like you and it happens naturally. The real question is the visibility, right? There's just a certain percentage of the YouTube viewer population that would be really interested in the Jay Barino brand content if they were simply exposed to it. And it's not about me changing a million things in order to appeal to a wider audience. It's simply making sure that what I'm doing is reaching the people that would like it if they saw it. And I think that's an interesting way to look at, again, disconnecting marketing from depersonifying your audience, right? Because I think when you're advertising and kind of like preying upon your own audience to gain money and subscriptions or whatever you need, you know, just going after them, you assign them all as just numbers, right? You're all just an amorphous blob of subscribers. How can I get a percentage of you to pay me, right? That's how it's treated by a lot of folks because this is their job. It's their full-time job and they need to some extent, right? For me, again, I try to separate that aspect of saying I'm more just interested in the visibility of my channel. If folks can see it, maybe they'll like it. And if they don't, I'd prefer that they just didn't watch it as opposed to me trying to convince them to watch it. So it's very different where, again, if someone was doing this mainstream as part of their main job, they are going to look to appeal to the widest audience possible. Whereas, again, I'm looking at it more as I want to appeal to the people that already like what I'm doing and finding more people who would fit into that. I guess that's the same attitude I would treat with my comment section and my Discord server. Again, curating your space to what you want it to be as opposed to just opening it up and go hog wild simply so I can get as many people as possible. I think that's a mistake. But again, have it be welcoming such that people are available to come in who may not be super well-versed but are interested and getting them involved. All right, well, this has been a long one. It's been a random stream of consciousness. I'd love to hear, you know, anybody's input on the type of games we're playing, how I play them, you know, what personality I can bring that has gotten you interested. And it's not as simple as, hey, just play this other type of game, right? I understand that. I've got a big old list. I keep track of all those suggestions made to me, but it's more, you know, what is it about the brand that you all like so that I can keep doing that, right? Because I just want the final point is, like, I'm not really that interested or concerned. I'm not concerned about just, like, how many more people, how many more views can we get? I've really enjoyed what I've done. And I think a lot of other people do, too, and value it as entertainment. And how do I build upon that as opposed to, let's just get as many viewers as possible. Let's go crazy. How do we do it? You know, that's not really where I'm going. All right. Well, thanks everyone for watching. I really appreciate your feedback. See you next time. Bye-bye.